earlier that part of the evidence of your leadership was what happened last year at FunCon. And I would like to dig in a little bit more. I would like to start by naming that there are many different perspectives and lots of feelings about it. And I also want to name that some of you weren't here, either because you didn't make it last year or because this is your very first time here.
Stories in the room, then we have the next challenge. The next challenge is the fact
church. Thank you for the Not all stories are equally valuable in the project of liberation. And that is different than to say not all stories are valid. Of course all stories are valid because the stories go with the identities, go with the people. Hello, inherit worth and dignity of every person, yes. Right? Like, absolutely, your perspective, your story is valid. But in the project of liberation, we are looking for specific stories to help us move. And how do we do that respectfully is something I'm still working out. But I want to at least name it, that we are in this project of everybody and then also not so much. Like, it's complicated, it's really weird. So okay, one way that I look for value for the project of liberation, is this gonna help me in the project of liberation? Is if the person telling the story has a lived experience of the oppression that we are speaking about. And if I perceive that I have more privilege than that person, then that's an opportunity for me to zip it. Listen and learn more, expand the stuff that maybe I don't know that I don't know because I haven't lived it, right? And here again, it's simple, but it's complicated because on the one hand, it's simple. The person who lives it is the person who knows it. And it's not about putting people with target identities on pedestals. And it's not about asking them to do all the work. And it's absolutely not about going to ask for absolution because we fucked up again. So I want to name that it's easy to say, leave the person with a tired identity alone, but it's really hard to do. And I think it's because we have this impulse to redeem ourselves. And I don't know if you've had this experience, but I certainly have. I have put my foot in my mouth with my friends who have disabilities or who are trans. And the moment that I am called back in very lovingly and said, you know, Beth, I have this like really intense urge to explain my whole life and why that wasn't what I meant. Like really intense urge to like explain all of how I am one of the good ones. Really, I swear, I am one of the good ones in society. And it's hard. Like that is so hard to resist that urge. That I think is part of the work that we need to do, is to learn how to deliver an apology really cleanly for the other person. Oh man, I'm sorry I did that. Done. And then you go to your friend and like, I'm a good one. Okay. And that's what your friends are for. To do that restoration work. Not with the person that you injured, right? Like that is one of the ways in which we ask our religious professionals of color, our trans people, our people with disabilities, to constantly reassure us that we're okay, that it's gonna be okay. And that's what we want to start interrupting. That's part of the things that we don't want to do anymore. So I invite you to use your caucus space. I invite you to go with people who are like you to say, I feel like crap, I did it again, I don't understand, I'm having all these feelings. Like, white fragility is real, and I don't want to play whack-a-mole with white fragility. I'm tired of, like, white fragility, you can't. No, white fragility, bam, bam, bam. It's not productive. White fragility is real. It's a set of emotions that white people have when they realize their complicity in the system. It sucks. But neither do I want white fragility in every space. I would like it in white caucus, please. Take it there. I think that's one of the things that we can do in our caucus space. And if you want to be my ally in liberation, I'm going to invite you to stay in deep and close relationship with me. And I'm going to invite you to know that I am both resilient and fragile, strong and triggered. So like, for example, if you're my friend, you know that Kavanaugh hit me completely sideways. I am still quite dysfunctional, right? And you know that ever since 45 was in the White House, I have really been struggling with all the immigration shit that I've had to deal with. If you're my friend, you know that, because I'm a survivor of assault and I'm an immigrant. But if you're my friend, you also come and say, how are you doing today? You don't assume that I'm already broken, and you don't assume that I got it all together, I'm gonna fix it for everyone. You engage with me in a conversation of, how is it today? How is it with your soul? That is what I want from my allies. The complexity, the permission to be different on different days. Sometimes to have it together, and other days, not so much. And for me to be able to say, today, yes, yes, I wanna educate you today, let me help you. And no, today, no, today, I can't. I can't today. And that's okay. Like, that's part of the dance that I want to create, and I want to create room for that for all of us. What do you think? Yeah? All right. Speaking of that, and speaking of taking care of our feelings, could I please have the chaplains in the room rise and be known? Say thank you to these people.
She's been working on me for a while. Ellen Bishop drink. So, you know, I knew it wasn't great, and I went to bed. And I also had had a concussion the month before. So, you know,
yeah, I was a little off. And so, okay.
So, went to bed, got up the next morning, blah, blah, blah. Oh, we did our announcements,
right?
And it started up again. I did not sleep Friday night, so I went to bed. I thought, oh my God, I just gotta go, right? So I went to bed, and about an hour later, Jules Javio, thank you Jules, on the board, called me up. I'm trying to meditate, I'm just trying to get some rest. And she calls me up and said, get your ass down here, a shit's in the van. And came down and heard what had been happening.
Yep.
That people of color had been speaking up, saying this is not okay. I mean, a whole variety of feedback had been given to the presenters the night before, had been given that morning, and the room, the lobby, was in an uproar. And the board kind of had this conversation from the elevator to the room, saying, we just have to stop this. So I came to the mic and said, we're stopping this programming. And took a breath.
Yeah.
Didn't know what was gonna happen.
Yeah.
And invited the people of color, said the board would be in such and such a room, and invited people of color to come and talk to us about what their experience was.
And I'm gonna try to summarize a little more. And then that's where the co-creation happened, and then you created a whole new thing with and for each other, yeah?
Yeah.
So first we heard the truth about how harmful it had been.
Yeah.
And then those people of color who came and spoke to us graciously, generously, kindly created new programming for us.
And I see you have feelings about that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was an extraordinary gift of an experience that I know was my growth, my awakening was on the backs of people who were deeply hurt by this.
Yes.
And that's really painful.
Thank you for having me. Yeah. Yeah. And when we talked about it earlier, when we were plotting this, I also heard you say that there were elements of like real surprise for you. Like that this was a like, oh wait. Oh, like that you saw it at this whole other level. Did I get that right?
Oh yeah. I mean, in a whole bunch of ways.
Yeah.
And in the years since.
Right.
I think that, I mean, just simply that notion that if programming is hurtful, why would we go on?
Right.
Why would we go on? And the fact that Friday night, when it was so hurtful to me, that I left.
Yeah.
And that wasn't just because I had a concussion. It was because, I'm a Kavanaugh survivor. And I was not gonna stay in that room with that behavior, with those requests, with those demands.
Right.
But it never, ever occurred to me Friday night
right.
to stop and say no. But I will say, and this is part of my story, part of the joy and honor of being the president of Laredo last year is that I got to fire. And it was a clear decision not to explain to them, not to take our time and our energy. Thank you, people of color. My energy was not going to be spent explaining to them why we were fired. That was a deep joy and pleasure.
And for other people in the room, so what else do you need to say to have your experience and story be complete?
Thank you. Thank you for that, Roger. You know, I think that the one other thing that I would add is a recognition that this could happen because of the spring of discontent, the April of our discontent. There was no accident that people of color spoke up at the Marina Four Conference when something was hurtful that year and said, no more. I know Lorena has been hurtful to people, totally unintentionally, and it was that year that Lorena, that people found, had their voice and said, no more, no more. I'm in the room, it's gonna be for me too.
Thank you, Anna.
Thank you.
I'm just so grateful to you, Chris. things, and I've said this to you before, and I am doing this anti-racism work, and I'm wondering why you have to give the shit, and I don't. Or if I will too, like, maybe I just haven't poked the right bear yet? I don't know. You know, like, it's really scary. Like, for me personally, it's really scary, and I feel a personal commitment to you and to your family. It's not theoretical. And I think that many people in this room feel that way. I hope you feel loved. And I want to name that this that we're feeling right now in the room, this feeling of heavy, this is also part of the work. And another thing that I learned this past week, actually I relearned it. I learned it originally when I was at Meanville and Derek taught it to me then, but he brought it back to this work that we were doing earlier this week in UUMA committee work. The power of lament. The power of prayer. So another thing that I want to name about what we need to be able to do as we do this work is we need to be with it. We need to feel it. Because the story is here, right, Erica? I mean, like, that's the story that Erica was telling. The story and the evil is here, it's happening. And then what? So I'm gonna invite us all into a space of prayer and of lament. Will you join me? Diosa de la justicia y diosa de la paciencia, y diosa del cambio. Goddess of justice and goddess of patience and goddess of change. Join us, please, here, now. Help us and give us strength. Make yourself known in our bones. For we are weary of the work and scared of the very scary people and just plain tired. We found this faith and this faith found us, but sometimes we don't know why we stay. That which once fed us now leaves us hungry and thirsty. We are being asked to do too much, and our families are bearing the brunt of the work. Es demasiado, querida Diosa, es mucha la carga. It's too much. Acompáñanos, be with us. You are always available when we open the door of our hearts. You are there when we feel alone. Remind us that we are not and never have been alone. Remind us that we can sit in your lap. Help us remember to take a break, to take shifts at the revolution. Bring our ancestors to our minds and hearts. Give our souls the fire to keep going. Help us catalyze the anger and the stress into change and transformation. Remind us of how far we've come from where our people started. Bring to our heart and minds the many people who love us and are with us. Let us feel the energy of their love and hope. Please bring our allies to the party and stoke the fire in their belly and give them courage to take risks and try things, even if we don't know how it's going to go. For so much more is possible when we feel your presence among us. We are the ones that make lemonade. We are your hands in the world. We are the change makers and the risk takers. And we are here in Unitarian Universalism, and though some days that is puzzling, most days it feels right and good, and this is the place that we are meant to be. We know that as we name you, we feel you. We claim the things we need and we receive them gratefully. For you are we and we are you, and as we pray this, we make it so. Bendita seas y bendita somos. Blessed be, and blessed we are. Amen.